Welcome to this evening's council meeting. I'm Mayor Ted Schaefer, and with me this evening are my council colleagues. I have Councilor Jack Arnold, Councilor Paul Albrecht, Councilor Rudy Stortaboom, Councilor Gail Martin, Councilor Val Vanderbroek, and Councilor Nathan Pahal. At the staff table, we have Darren Light, our Director of Corporate Services, Carolyn Machada, Manager of Legislative Services, Francis Chung, our CAO. On the other side of the room, we have Gerald Minchuk, Director of Development Services and Economic Development, Rick Baumhoff, Director of Engineering, Parks and Environment, and Kim Hilton, Director of Recreation, Culture and Community Services, and later on, Rory Thompson, our Fire Chief, will be up. Wonder why. Anyway, the adoption of the agenda is the first item on here, that the November 7th, 2016 agenda be adopted as circulated. I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Martin and Councillor Albrecht and Councillor Martin.
Yes, I'd like to add under motions a motion for the Soroptomist Club of Langley, please.
All right. Motions. That's 9A2. Anything else? All those in favor? As amended? Thank you. It's unanimous. Adoption of the minutes, that the minutes of the regular meeting held on October 17th, 2016 be adopted as circulated. Mover and a seconder. Councillor Vanderbroek and Councillor Pahal. All those in favor? Against? The first item we have is a delegation. And we have Jim Smith. And he'll go up to the mic. And he is going to be bringing Ted Levitt along with him. And what we are doing today is saying goodbye to a gentleman that's been in the community for, well, since 1977. Jim Smith, Langley Youth and Family Services. Langley Youth and Family Services is an early intervention crime prevention program that provides service to the community through child, youth, and family counseling. The program is fully funded by the city and township of Langley and received referrals mostly from the RCMP. Jim Smith has been leading the program since its inception almost 40 years ago. Wow. Jim has decided to retire, and tonight we'd like to thank him for his service to the community and take the opportunity to introduce his successor, Ted Levitt. Ted has been with the LYFS for the past year as a counselor on staff and will now be stepping up into the program manager role. Jim will remain on staff as just a counselor, he says, filling a one-year maternity vacancy. This is great because it will give Ted an opportunity to have a mentor for 1 year. We would like to offer congratulations to Ted and wish him and the rest of the crew over there much success in the work that they're doing with the youth. And to Jim, all the best for nearly 40 years of dedicated service. And with that, the highly sought after certificate of appreciation, right?
Thank you very much.
Would you like to say a few words?
I sure would, yes. Mayor Schaefer, I'd like to thank you personally and your council members for the kindness and respect and support you've shown myself and, of course, the service, Langley Youth and Family Services, and thanking your council that was here before you and before them and before but it has been a continuous warm support. I also want to take a moment to just acknowledge the support staff here at the city, Darren for sure, and all the others who on a daily basis I meet them, and they're always friendly and kind, and it's just been a wonderful place to work. It's in fact, when I first came here to Langley and got going with the program, I said to people, I retired. So it doesn't get better than that, and I'm glad I can be around for another year. And it's also my pleasure this evening to introduce Ted Levitt, who, as you say, has been with us for a year. Ted has a varied background, which I think is going to be unique to taking over the service. He's worked in drug and alcohol counseling with adults. He's spent time in research in the field of psychology and other fields. He's a trained systemic family therapist. He has his own private practice, and he's bringing some very unique insights and skills with him, specifically tailored to the youth and the youth issues that we encounter here in the District of Langley. In the year that he's been here, he has presented himself around the topic of youth behavior and underlying issues to do with those youth behaviors at some of our high schools and in some of our public forums, and has had a very, very warm response, a lot of that response being reported directly back to me. So perhaps without any further ado, Ted, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
And,
yeah, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
And you have big shoes to fill here.
I do, yeah.
Yeah. And, yeah, well, we'll see you around off and on for the next 12 months or 11 months or so, and you have a great mentor.
Yes, I know. Thank
Thanks
you.
Very much. Thank you again.
Thanks a lot.
And now I'd like to ask Francis Chung, our CAO, to come on up.
I think you have to stand there, and recipients have to stand here.
Righty. There we go. We're doing some long service award recognitions here this evening. And the first one is Kara Jefford.
So Kara Jefford was hired as an infrastructure engineer in October 2011. Come on up, Kara. She was promoted to the Manager of Engineering Services in February of 2013. Kara oversees the day-to-day function of the engineering division, including looking after engineering matters regarding development applications, infrastructure planning, and capital works construction. Over the last couple of years, the city has received around $6.6 million in federal, provincial, and TransLink capital funding grants, and that's no small feat for a community of our size to receive that much grants from the all levels of governments. And Kara has certainly played a key role in pursuing these grants applications. Alongside her team in the engineering division, Kara provides excellent customer service and represents the department really well. Please join me in congratulating Kara on a 5-year service at the City of Langley. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thanks. Stay over here, Kara. We're going to embarrass them a little bit later.
Okay.
Next one is Leah Miller.
So Leah began working for the city in 2009 as a seasonal laborer in the Parks Operations Department. She graduated that same year from Kwantlen Polytechnic University with a diploma in horticultural technology and started right away putting her knowledge to work in maintaining and beautifying the city parks. Her technical training combined with her love of gardening allowed Leah to showcase her talents and gain a full-time position as the horticultural maintenance charge hand in August of 2011. While she loved gardening, Leah's passion in trees, and in May 2011 she became a certified arborist with the International Society of Arboriculture. She continued her training in arboriculture and in 2014 became qualified as a tree risk assessor. Leah has done extensive work throughout the city on tree planting, establishing tree pruning programs, and assessing identified hazard trees in the city parks and roadways. In March of 2015, Leah moved to the position of city gardener and has been responsible for leading the city's hanging basket program, planters, annual and bulb plantings, and continues to improve her parks tree management program. Leah is a strong advocate for the city's urban forest and maintaining the parks in an environmentally responsible manner. She's a dedicated, respected, and valued member of the parks team, and she shows great pride and commitment in her work and the way she represents the city. We wish Leah continued success with her career here at the city. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have, from the fire department, Micah Rosenagel.
Micah, actually, I know Micah as a lifeguard when I first met Micah. So Michael started working for the city when he was 16 years old, as I mentioned, as a lifeguard.
16.
Serving many summers at Allenderson Pool. And after university, Micah went on to become a high school teacher in 2006, teaching physical education, social studies, and English at Mountain Secondary School. Micah began his firefighter career with Langley City Fire Rescue in 2004 as a pay-on-call firefighter and later a paid-on-call captain. He was hired as a career firefighter in 2011. Congratulations on your 5-year service, Micah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you. Next, we have Kyle Simpson.
Kyle was hired as superintendent of engineering operations in August of 2011. He was promoted to manager of engineering operations in November 2013. Kyle oversees the day-to-day functions of the engineering operations division, which includes critical functions such as water distribution and water quality monitoring, storm and sanitary collection, signs, street lighting, and signal maintenance, and roads and fleet maintenance. Kyle has also volunteered to be the city's leader on the United Way fundraising campaign for the past 2 years, where his dedications help raise money for worthy causes. Kyle's attention to detail and strong work ethic is very much appreciated. Please join me in congratulating Kyle on his 5-year service at the City of Langley. Congratulations.
Thank you.
There we go. Our fire chief, Rory Thompson.
Rory started the city on January 17, 2011 as a fire chief. Rory has over 42 years of public safety experience, starting as a volunteer firefighter in 1974 before becoming a police officer slash firefighter in 1981, culminating as a fire chief on Vancouver Island. In 2005, Rory joined the faculty of the Justice Institute of BC as Program Director, Professional Programs, in charge of fire training programs for the province, serving there for 5.5 years before becoming the fire chief for the City of Langley. In his spare time, Rory serves as a reservist with the Royal Canadian Navy. He served as the commanding officer of the 5 RCSCC Rainbow from 2001 to 2003, with the responsibility of supervising 8 officers and approximately 110 cadets. Rory currently serves as commanding officer of the 354 RCSCC Invincible. Congratulations, Rory.
Congratulations. Next, we have Sonia Costa. Sonia.
I actually first met Sonia when she was a flag person working for a flagging company. That was when I was the engineer, when I came back as a CEO, and Sonia was working as a staff at the City of Langley, and that was as a laborer in 2004. Her first role with the city was that of the garbage collector, back when garbage collection was separated between the parks operation and engineer operations divisions. Sonia spent 2 years as a casual employee before being successful in the full-time construction laborer competition. Sonia has held many different roles here at the city. She was the trades improver 2 on the maintenance crew. She was the relief storekeeper buyer, and most recently, Sonia was successful in becoming the tradesperson. Sonia holds certificates in both water distribution and wastewater collection. She has also been a level 2 first aid attendant and recently completed the public works inspection course. As you can see, Sonia is not afraid of hard work and is always up for a challenge. She is an avid animal lover. She has 2 dogs and a cat, and would take on many more animals if she could. Sonia is also a talented baker, baking cakes that put professional bakers to shame. And I think that's it. Congratulations. Oh, no, actually more. Sorry, there's next page, more. In her current role of the city, Sonia acts as the first responder to trouble calls. She deals tactfully with the public, she diffuses difficult situations, and she resolves issues out in the field all on her own. She liaises with contractors and provides them with guidance, information needed so that they can complete their work. Sonia's dedication to the city and her can-do attitude make her a cherished member of the engineering operations team. Congratulations.
Wow.
Now I'm done.
Very good.
Thank you.
Yeah. Next individual is Deborah Joel.
Deborah began with the city in January of 2001 as a clerk at the Douglas Recreation Center. She moved to the Corporate Services Department for 1 year as a receptionist and moved to the Administration Department as the mayor's executive assistant 9 years ago. Deborah is usually the first face one sees when they come to the Administration Department, and is always a happy one. Deborah has amazing talent for customer service and goes above and beyond. Thank you, Deborah. Thank you.
Next individual is Paula Cusack.
Paula started her career at the City of Langley in January 2001. Paula started her career at the city in January 2001 as a receptionist in the Corporate Services Department. She moved to the Administration Department as administrative assistant in 2005 and promoted to the Deputy Corporate Officer 1 year later. Paula plays a significant role to council preparation meeting agenda, organizing meetings, and providing support to various committees. Paula's knowledge and ability to work on and keep track of a multitude of projects is greatly appreciated. Thank you and congratulations.
Thank you. Now it's my turn. The individual standing next to me, Francis Chung. Francis is a mover and a shaker, graduating as a professional engineer from UBC in 1991, studying public sector management at UVic, and completing the Queen's Executive Program at Queen's University in Ontario. He has acquired a great deal of knowledge and education over the years. Starting his municipal career in 1993 with the City of Port Coquitlam as a project engineer, Francis moved through the ranks and was promoted to assistant city engineer within 5 years. True to his nature, he sought out bigger challenges, and in the year 2000, the City of Langley was fortunate to hire him as our Director of Engineering. Within 1 year, the city, he added the Deputy City Manager to his portfolio. Francis stayed with us, and then he ditched off for 4 years. But eventually, he craved more. He went back to the City of Port Coquitlam in 2004 as a Director of Engineering and Approving Officer until 2006, when we enticed him back to the City of Langley. He is now our Chief Administrative Officer. This challenging position has kept him busy and engaged for 10 years. A lot of time there, quick. Francis has what it seems to be an insatiable thirst for knowledge. Throughout his career and personal life, he continues to grow and learn. He is involved in a multitude of organizations, way too many to mention here. He is a registered member of the Association of Professional Engineers and Geoscientists of BC, a member of the International City County Management Association, as well as the American Water Works Association and the American Public Works Association. But his latest achievement has been to attain his private pilot's license from Transport Canada. Francis has had many opportunities to regional advisory committees, both as a professional engineer and a chief administrative officer. His most recent appointment, chair of the RCMP Lower Mainland District Chief Administrator's Office Forum, that's a long one, followed by a five-year appointment as chair of the advisory committee for the RCMP integrated teams. You might think that Francis couldn't possibly have time for anything else, but you're wrong. He's also an avid volunteer. Since 2012, he's been a director for Success, one of the largest multicultural service agencies in BC. He has spent countless hours volunteering with the BC Summer Swimming Association, Swimming Canada, Langley Flipper Swim Club, Canoe Kayak Canada, and Operation Red Nose. I don't know how you do it all. Francis is a very accomplished man, and we're grateful to have him leading our team of staff here at the City of Langley. We appreciate his efficient and hardworking approach and recognize that he doesn't ask anything from a staff that he isn't willing to do himself. Congratulations on 10 years in a row.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Francis. Now, I'd like you to start the okay. Kara, if the rest of your colleagues and council would like to wish everybody? Nothing like getting you all embarrassed. Thank you. One thing about a small community, we really, well, it's not that others do not, but we're small enough that we can ask our staff to come in and thank them personally. And it's very important for this council to do that. They've always thought very highly of the team that's out there doing the work for the citizens of Langley. And the city of Langley is only 26,000 people, it's 10 square clicks, but we have a very dedicated staff, and their heart's as big as the great outdoors. So professionally speaking, I know they give it all, and every one of those people that came up here, do an excellent, excellent job. Well, even the firefighters that bailed on us, but they had a call to go to. That was what that horn was midway through. So we appreciate all that they do. So again, to the staff, many more years I hope to come. Thank you. So under Community Spotlight, this evening we have the Executive Director of the Downtown Langley BIA, and that is Ms. Terry James. Hello, Terry.
Yeah, I know, right? So I have to sit here. We've added some technology to the PowerPoint this year. So wish me luck. Okay, so I just want to thank everybody, Mayor and Council, members of city staff, the audience this evening for having me once again. It's my absolute pleasure to thank you for your support and to just kind of bring you a recap on the success of the 2016 McBurney Plaza Summer Series. So before I begin, I'd like to share a brief introduction with anyone who may or may not know as how this came about in the first place. So in 2015, the City of Langley once again won the Open for Business Award from the province of BC, and I say once again, because they'd won it before that, but this was the first time that the money was earmarked for events in the newly refurbished back then McBurney Plaza. So they won it again, and for the second year in a row, the city decided to use that funding to partner with the Downtown Langley Business Association to create a series of events that would attract people to the beautiful McBurney Plaza. So by working with a variety of sponsors, some of which are professionals, some of which are here this evening, engaging the business community, etc., we feel we were successful for the second year in a row in bringing to the City of Langley a series of events at absolutely no cost to anyone who came down to enjoy them. And there's no question in our minds that these events have truly put the City of Langley on the map. The feedback from the public, municipal officials, city staff and the business community has been extremely positive, and we're already brainstorming some very creative ideas for 2017 that I can't wait to share with you. So in order to advertise the events and get the most bang for our buck, we chose to carefully plan the avenues we would use, and they worked very well. We advertised in newspapers, printed postcards that were handed out at all of the other downtown events, ran magazine ads, used electronic media, printed and distributed posters, created street signage, and hosted various social media contests. We also took advantage of the free opportunities available to us through Tourism Langley, who attended every single one of our McBurney Plaza Summer Series events and also gave us their awnings and canopies for free. The Chamber of Commerce, the City of Langley, and any other opportunity to post our events online. And as a result, many local and lower mainland bloggers and influencers attended the events, and the word spread from there. So by retaining the same creative brand throughout the advertising campaign and notifying people that there was more to come, we feel that we maximized the advertising dollars in the most effective and efficient way possible. And as the word got out, each event was better attended than the last one. We were ready, rain or shine. The decision to hold the events from noon to 3 proved to be effective again for this year because we found that people came and went throughout the day, were able to check the events out, take in the shows at their leisure, and then further explore the city, which included eating in restaurants, a little retail therapy, and taking the ambiance of the city in general. And we got this positive feedback from people who took the time to attend. So I'm just going to give you a brief overview of the events as they transpired. So the first one was on Saturday, June 25th, and we called this one Party in the Plaza. This was our kickoff to summer, and the sound of steel drums could be heard all over town. Match Eatery and Public House came out to join the fun and provided delicious food. And 2015 BC Country Music nominee Andrew Christopher played his backyard warm weather hits. The Freezy Tiki Hut was a huge success, and people had a blast in the photo booth, and the take-home caricatures made for awesome keepsakes. And keep in mind that absolutely everything is free. So here's where the technology kicks in. We managed to get little videos on 4 of the 5, so wish me luck. So that just gives you a little snippet of what that looked like. And all of the videos were taken at the onset of the events because it literally got way too busy to take videos at any other time. So that was just the start. Then the next one we brought along on Saturday, July 9th, was Big Top in the Plaza. Circus West joined us with illusionists, juggling performances, and crystal ball magic. Scruffles the Clown twisted up his amazing balloon creations, and everyone was invited to visit the interactive juggling tent to see if they're ready to run away and join the circus, and I found out I'm definitely not. Hundreds of little and big faces were painted, and free popcorn was enjoyed by all. So again, just a few pictures to give you an overview, and you can see that as the events progressed, the crowds increased as well. So just a quick video to share.
Each, some,
yeah, these guys were fantastic. We only had a few small ones, so I picked that one. Then we had Music in the Plaza, and this one was pretty extraordinary because we were extremely fortunate to have Juno nominee and ukulele aficionado James Hill and his lovely wife, Anne Janelle, join us for this afternoon of amazing and toe-tapping music. And they featured a lot of songs for their many, many successful albums, and we were only able to secure them through the relationships that exist with themselves, so James Hill and Rare Affairs. They all played the ukulele ensemble when they were little, and James went on to be, he actually went on to be quite famous, and he brought his own entourage, as you will see from the pictures and also the short video I'm going to share with you. So we also brought in a musical playground that the kids played on that was filled with unique instruments made from salvaged and upcycled materials. And then in between the performances of James and Anne, we brought in the Drumline kids, and I also have a short video of them. Ages 13 to 16, and they performed at the Olympics and the Canucks games, and they're basically there to get the crowds going, and you'll see why in a moment. They came all the way over from Vancouver Island to get the crowd going, and what I found most intriguing about this whole thing was there was some debate as to whether or not, you know, following the mellow music of the ukulele one that, believe me, they don't even sound like ukuleles. This man can make it sound like any instrument in the world, but in between the sort of specific genre of the music between James Hill and the Drumline, we anticipated maybe a little bit of transition, and I will honestly say that some of the seniors in the audience were, when the Drumline first started, they were just like, ugh, kind of hit them, and then by the end of it, they were absolutely 100% into it. So it was a really cool thing to do. The transition was perfect. I'm glad we did it. So here's just the short video of James and Anne. You can see the crowds, too. They're just huge. There was one lady that came from the States that was very intense. She showed up 2 hours before this performance, so she had a seat. She wasn't going to miss out. So you can just imagine having that sort of ambiance and then hitting people with this, but it honestly worked out fabulous. And this was just the warm-up for these kids, if you can imagine. They just got increasingly better. Yeah. So I could have watched these guys all day. It was really that intriguing. So this is the only one we didn't manage to secure a video for, and it's because it was probably one of the busiest ones in terms of us having to keep active. We had so many things going on. So this was Saturday, August the 6th, and we brought in animals in the plaza. So we did bring back the crawling, slithering, hopping, climbing critters from the Urban Safari Rescue Society, because, you know, who technically doesn't want to be around all those things? We brought in the unique and beautiful birds from the Orphaned Wildlife Rehabilitation Society. We had a professional dog trainer on hand giving tips and tricks with agility and free pony rides that happened in the south end of McBurney Plaza. So there was constantly things going on, and again, it was completely enjoyed by everyone. And last but definitely not least, on September the 17th was Science World, as you guys probably heard me say last year. So we had rubber chicken slingshots, electrical demos, some explosions. They thoroughly enjoyed Langley to the point where they've asked us if they can please come back for 2017. They felt that they, because it was an inclement weather day, they didn't have the crowds that we were hoping for. But there were still crowds, as you can see. And there were some things that they were unable to do just because the weather, when you're dealing electricity and water and stuff, sometimes it doesn't mesh. So they've pretty much asked us if they can come back. So we're definitely looking into that. So anyway, people just had an absolute blast. They came and enjoyed. And again, this being the last one, it was a little bit sad, I must say. So I just have a little video here with this little girl who was so cute. Give her a big round of applause! That was awesome! She worked very hard to do that, actually. She was a cutie. So I just wanted to share this slide. So that was basically a recap, very brief recap of the 2016 events that happened in the plaza. I hope you can see from the pictures and things that I've shared with you. I couldn't share them all. There's hundreds and hundreds of photos, but just really positive experiences happening in the plaza. So this is just a brief overview of the total budget for the plaza series, showing both the hard costs and the in-kind costs that we were able to leverage as sponsorships. So I believe I sent council, mayor and council, the actual hard copy of this in a letter I wrote recently. But I just wanted to show those in the audience that this is, we were able to secure over $50,000 worth of events in our downtown. And for those of you who were able to come to some or all of them, I'm sure you'll agree that it was worth every penny. They were truly awesome. So next, we have percolating for 2017. So here's what we're thinking. Sports in the plaza. So this is just a little tagline that we're going to use. Do you have a little one who dreams of playing professional hockey, football, or soccer? Come down to McBurney Plaza for your chance to meet local sports celebrities. Player appearances include members of the Canucks, the BC Lions, and the Vancouver Whitecaps. Take part in an interactive activity with the Langley Rivermen. And if you're lucky, you may even get to snap a photo with a mascot or two. So that's just the bare beginning of the idea process. Jedi's in the plaza, and I didn't even know how popular this stuff was. I was like, Jedi's in the plaza? It turns out it's a real thing. So Jedi's from all areas of the galaxy are invited to join together for special Jedi training in McBurney Plaza. Jedi Master Obi-Kai Kenobi, teacher of the Force and lightsaber, will share his skills and knowledge with the young Jedi students. But be warned, the Galactic Empire is aware of the strong presence of the Force, and you may be called to do battle with the dark side. So then we're going to bring in Aquarium in the Plaza. So we're going to welcome the Vancouver Aquarium through hands-on exploration about aquatic life from around the world. Kids will learn, as will adults. This unique opportunity welcomes all ages to explore the richness of life below the surface. Enjoy the view of life within a tide pool through a mobile aquarium and discover connections between aquatic, the environment, and ourselves. And as mentioned, Science World 2.0, we're going to be bringing back Science World's on the road program. And again, just through confirmation and preliminary conversations, it's going to be bigger and better. And they really do want a dry day, if possible, because they can bring so much more. And the last but definitely not least, what we're discussing is world music. Nothing gets your toes tapping like amazing music. McBurney Plaza will be hopping as the sound of music from around the world fills the air. We're going to bring culture, tradition, and sound together in high-energy live performances, which will include jaw-dropping displays of music, dance, and aerobics. We guarantee you won't be able to stand still. So again, this is just the beginning of the conversations and some of the ideas that the team has put together that we think will draw even bigger crowds for 2017. So getting towards the end of my presentation, there are a few people that I definitely want to thank, starting with the City of Langley. Thanks for once again putting your faith in us and allowing us to bring these amazing events to the downtown, particularly into McBurney Plaza. And I say this with all sincerity. A couple of years ago, I remember having a conversation, what are we, right? We've gone over that year after year. Are we international? Are we cars? Are we horses? We've always established that that's kind of doesn't describe appropriately the uniqueness of this little city that we have. And somebody, may have even been me, but I do recall a conversation where somebody said, well, why don't we just have a cool place where you can say there's always something going on down there? That's exactly what's happened. There's always something happening in this little community now. And people are enjoying it, and we're becoming more and more well-known throughout the Lower Mainland. I've had multiple visits with executive directors from other BIAs since we started launching these unique things, asking me how do we do it? And I start every conversation with, make sure you have an epic relationship with your city and your mayor and council. So without your financial support and for the vision, none of this would be possible. So honestly and sincerely, thank you. And in the audience with me this evening is a woman who needs absolutely no introduction. This is Cheryl Parsons. She is the owner with her husband Chris of Rare Affairs Meeting and Event Planning. They have amazing ladies that work for them as well, Laura and Jen. And they have everything to do with what we're able to produce this year and the year before. Their vision, creativity, hard work, and dedication, ideas come to reality. This partnership is tremendous fun. But we were able to bring life to top quality, family-oriented, professionally run events for everyone to enjoy. Honestly, no idea is ever too big, no challenge isn't met, and as the events develop, I can honestly say that there isn't another event organization that I could ask for as far as working with. And all in for 2017 as well. So, and another person responsible, and you've heard me mention this name before, is Vanessa Renee from Renee Creative. She was the one who originally created the vision for the branding of the plaza, taking the photo and producing it, or rearranging it and making it something that people could relate to. This is going to be the brand for McBurney Plaza Summer Series going forward. We've just decided it's recognizable. Essentially, we can just swap things out, and I don't know if you noticed on the budget, but Vanessa's modest cost was $1,000 to do all the advertising. I mean, she obviously gave us in-kind efforts as well. But she charged us $1,000 to do all that creative. She's got to size all the ads, make sure they're at the newspapers on time. She does all the banners for the websites and stuff like that. So that in itself is pretty outstanding. And last, but definitely not least, we have a media partner, the Langley Advance. And the Langley Advance is amazing at recognizing the value of community events, and they're always there for us. So they matched our print and advertising dollars, dollar for dollar, again this year. So that essentially worked out to about $3,500 worth of free advertising. So yeah, we want to thank them as well. So that is the end of my presentation, and I would love to hear from members of council or anyone that has a question about this year or 2017.
Councillor Pahal.
Thank you very much for that presentation. It's just amazing the kind of work that gets put on to put this together. I don't know if you heard, but we got an award for McBurney Plaza for the design of it from an architectural magazine
you
this
did.
Year.
That's right.
And just to see this kind of event, which is high quality and truly world class, I mean, it just complements it perfectly and builds that brand of a positive downtown and bringing these activities. And it was really interesting because during one of the events, a friend of mine from New Zealand who works for Auckland Council was there, and he was a little bit jealous of our downtown. And I mean, they have their big downtown core, but as far as their communities, they said, I wish we could do things like that in New Zealand. So tremendous praise for the event and
Thank
all the
you.
Hard work.
Thank you.
Councillor Vanderbrook.
Yeah, I just want to echo those sentiments. Fantastic job, Terry. I only missed one this year, unfortunately. I was out of town. Last year, I made them all. Great, and I love that you're mixing them up, and I am super excited about the Jedi night one. I'm in, so anything you need for it, you let me know.
Thank you. I just have to reiterate on that note, Councillor Vandenbroek, thank you. I cannot take credit for this. I am simply the overseer of things to make sure it comes together. The creative minds and the cooperation and the relationships that have developed just from putting these events together is outstanding. It'll serve the DLBA and the City of Langley well into the future for sure. So thanks for pointing that out.
Councillor Storbrum, then Martin, then Albrecht.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Terry. Awesome, just really, really great. Thank you to you and your team and the Merchants Association and your sponsors. You had something going pretty much every Saturday all summer long. It wasn't just these wonderful events, but a whole string of activities. So, you know, parents could get up on Saturday morning and ask the kids, what do you want to do? And they'd say, let's go to downtown Langley because that's where it's going on.
Yeah.
It was fantastic. You really put us on the map with these activities. And I got to tell you, of all of the events that we have, these are the ones that I get the best feedback from. These are the ones where people really have a great time, the kids are learning stuff, and it's really stimulating, and even when it's raining, you know, it's great fun. And it really instills a sense of pride, not just in me, but the people who live here who come to these events. They're really proud to be in the City of Langley, in large part because they feel connected through these events. So thank you, and your team, and your sponsors. It was great. Money
thank
well spent.
You.
Thank you.
Councillor Martin.
Thank you. Well, thanks, Terry. I had the pleasure of attending every event this summer, four of them with my granddaughter, which I'm always happy to be there with. But, you know, McBurney Plaza, when we bit the bullet and decided to spend a lot of money on refurbishing, this is exactly what we wanted to see in McBurney Plaza. So kudos to you and your group and the sponsors. I mean, I know you couldn't do it without the sponsors, certainly. And I look forward to this every summer now. I mean, we're coming up our third summer next year. I even keep the posters in my garage, you know, because they're absolutely beautiful. I mean, I remember the first time you showed them to us. It was just, they're gorgeous. And Vanessa Renee, I mean, she is just so talented in bringing this stuff together. So I'll certainly look forward to, we'll all look forward to 2017. And hopefully we can support you again. I'm hoping for that. But congratulations to you and your team. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful time for the City of Langley when you have these events.
Thank you. It's definitely a good vibe, that's for sure.
Councillor Albrecht.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, the energy, the fun, the life, the downtown just explodes with it. And I know myself, and I think other members of council really appreciate your partnership and your team's work and the effort they put into making things so successful. I find this is really becoming the heartbeat of our community, and I just want to say thank you so much.
Oh, you're so very welcome. And if I just might add too, it's just in putting together this team that's so willing. And again, somebody pointed out that there was something happening every single Saturday, or it felt like, in downtown Langley. So just finding that team that's willing to sacrifice every single Saturday to bring something to our downtown needs to be mentioned as well, because that's it's a big part of what we do. Is we all look and go, okay, so we got no Saturdays to ourselves between now and October. How do we feel about that? And everybody's totally on board because it's doing nothing but bringing awesome things to the city. So thank you all very much.
Councillor Arnold.
Oh, I'm sorry, Jack. You were on the list.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, it's, I mean, the events, it's like people want to come here, not just to watch these events, but to be in them, the people that are putting on the events. This is one of the places they want to come and be at. It was nice to hear the drums tonight. I will be hearing them again Saturday at the Lions game, of course, and hopefully Winnipeg won't be too happy with them. But so we'd be hearing, seeing them then, seeing them again in McBurney. And the work that you guys do, I know you said something about there's certain, you know, it's certain people that get it done and so on, but it's your organization that puts it all together and brings it all to us. So thank you.
You're very welcome. And thank you all again for entrusting us with this. It means a lot.
I know Mr. Light doesn't have to fill in the line item on the budget. It was done, I think, automatically up here. So you don't have to worry about that one. When you get seven kudos like that, it's pretty, who's going to say no? So again, this couldn't be done without someone at the helm like yourself. You know, people can put parties together, but it takes a talent and a special knack and to work with the business community, and you've got that special knack.
Thank you.
You have a definite talent working with the people, not only for the city of Langley, but also for the greater Langleys combined. You give it your heart and your soul. You have a great contact base, and you use that for both communities. And from the bottom of my heart, and from on behalf of council, keep up the good work, and we'll see you around town as we always
awesome.
Do.
You're
always
Mayor
out
Schaefer.
And about. Thank you.
Thank you.
So now that we've done budget, guys. Yes. Okay. Public events, that's right. Okay, under the mayor's report, upcoming meetings, regular council meeting November 21st, 2016. Regular council meeting after that is December the 5th, and that one is televised. Metro Vancouver, Councillor Storteboom.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you to my council colleagues who were available to attend the Metro Vancouver Council of Councils meeting on Saturday, October the 22nd. In Vancouver at the P&E grounds. As you know, these Council of Council meetings are intended to provide all municipally elected officials in Metro with an update of important regional issues. Agenda items included a Metro budget overview, a 5-year business forecast, as well as a 10-year vision plan from TransLink CAO Kevin Desmond, an update from the Union of BC Municipalities, and an invitation to this year's Zero Waste Conference. It was a very worthwhile event. I appreciate those who were able to attend. Also, Council has received a fairly lengthy board and brief overview for the most recent Metro board and committee meetings, and those are included in your Council package. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Storteboom. Councillor Martin, Tourism Langley.
Thank you very much. This is going to be a little bit different report this month. As most of you have heard, Langley Township has made a decision which Tourism Langley is encouraging them to reevaluate the decision to support Tourism Langley and recognize the positive working relationship the organization has within the Langleys. At the October 18th Tourism Langley board meeting, the board of directors was notified by the Township of Langley in writing of their decision to commence exploring the opportunity to create a tourism entity with a focus on township-centric tourism initiatives. The notification was surprising given Tourism Langley was in their final stages of completing its 5-year renewal application to Destination BC and the Ministry of Finance. While this decision is within the Township of Langley's authority, Tourism Langley would like to affirm its dedication to the Langleys by referencing the last 9 years of its operation. Tourism Langley has been a positive experience for both Langleys as it has helped to identify, evolve, and promote the Township of Langley and the City of Langley tourism products, as well as continue to build and maintain strong working relationships with all of our stakeholders at national, provincial, regional, and local levels. Tourism Langley has created a robust and respected brand in the tourism industry, and we are confident we can continue to deliver vibrant tourism marketing programs and projects on behalf of the Langley's accommodation sector and local businesses now and in the future. And further to that, a letter was sent to the Township of Langley from the Tourism Industry Association of BC, wherein they state, and I quote, "As you are aware, Tourism Langley's work has led to 5 consecutive years of growth for Langley tourism operators, adding significant economic impact to the community, along with jobs and investment in tourism products and services. What's more, the organization is a recipient of the Professional Excellence Award and accomplished international accreditation through the DMAI and the DMAP within its first 5 years of operation. Suffice it to say, the delivery model for tourism marketing works exceptionally well with Tourism Langley operating in a cost-effective, transparent, professional, and accountable manner." And that's end of quote. As stated earlier, the township wants to create an entity with focus being on the township-centric tourism activities. Having been a member of the Board of Directors for the past 2 years, I can attest to the fact that between 85 and 90% of tourism Langley is township-centric. Furthermore, the Board of Directors has never had any dialogue with the township where they have stated they are unhappy with the content of tourism Langley, which is baffling given their plan to break up tourism Langley. As a matter of fact, Langley Tourism has just spent $100,000 plus on a campaign, a marketing campaign, including a video, which the whole campaign is on hold now. And in my opinion, 95% of that campaign is township-centric. So all I can say now is all we can do at this point is wait and see and hope that the decision does not go through with the Township of Langley. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Next, we're going to have an engineering update from Mr. Baumhoff, Director of Engineering, Parks and Environment.
All right, thank you. So as for the update in for November of 2016 for Engineering, Parks and Environment, the city participated in or sponsored a production called Dream Rider Productions. It's called H2O2O, and that is a play about water conservation. And that play was taken around to, or is being taken around to, four schools in the city. It's a through K-7 program. It runs for 40 minutes, and it's offered to all the city of Langley elementary schools. And so today it was Blacklock Fine Arts Elementary, as well as Nicomeckel Elementary. And tomorrow it's Simons Elementary, and November 9th it's Douglas Park Community. So it's a great program of a good way of reaching out to kids and teaching them about water conservation for the future. And as you well know, Hunter Park, we had decided to remove the fir trees and hemlock because of a disease called laminated root rot. So that has started last week, and will be continuing this week. So there's significant logging operation going on there right now. And we've interacted with many of the local residents. They've also walked around the site. And it's quite clear that with the trees that have been removed, it is spread throughout the whole park. So all of the firs and hemlocks will need to be removed. Jesus. So there are still a substantial number of cedars and other trees within the park. So it's not like it's a clear cut, but I think there's still lots of potential for it remaining as a passive style park. A lot of the people in the area commented that that's the kind of park that they would like it to remain. But so we will be reviewing the options as soon as the risk factor of the trees is removed. And the one picture here you see on the bottom left is a tree that largely the center of it is completely rotted out. So, and there's a number of other trees that we've witnessed that had substantial issues with them. So it's definitely a good positive thing that we're doing, is to remove those trees as a risk aversion. We also completed 51st Avenue east of 208th Street paving. You recall that we did the water main replacement there first, and now we replaced the curbs and paving within the road itself. The curbs and paving were in very poor condition, and the water main needed replacement, so we of course replaced the underground infrastructure first and now completed the paving and the curbs, and it looks like it's a very nice looking street, finished product. We also installed a large water meter structure at 62nd Avenue near the border of the Township of Langley. This allows the city and the township to supply water to each other for maintenance or emergency purposes in the situation where we might have an interruption of water for whatever reason. So it just gives us a courtesy connection between the two municipalities. And we've been doing some work, further work at Sendell Gardens in the lower kind of creek area. And this is just a little, like a snapshot of some of the work that we've been doing. On the right side, you'll see the old stairs. Those weren't really connected very well, and they're also a hazard. And those have been removed and replaced with the stairs that you see on the left. And they're basically kind of slab, rock slabs that we built into the bank and brought them up towards the top. There's been a lot of clearing in the Sendell Gardens area. We've also created more lawn areas. We put sod down. So if you haven't walked through there lately, I encourage you to take a look. It's a dramatic improvement of what's been done at Sendell Gardens and continues to be. So some current projects that we're working on in terms of construction is the traffic signal upgrade at 200th and Grade Crescent, the 203rd Street Roadworks and Roundabout Project, as well as trail and pedestrian walkway paving. Current design projects that we're working on, the Baldy Creek Culvert Replacement near 53rd Avenue. So that is right around the Bryden Park, Bryden Lagoon parking area, in that general vicinity near the hydro right-of-way. The 200 Street bridge deck replacement, that's being just awarded to a consultant to review, with the plans to replace the bridge deck in 2017, subject to budget approval, along with some other paving works south of the bridge. Also under design is the production way from Fraser Highway to 56th Avenue, doing conceptual design. And we have met with the local businesses there, and we've received some feedback from them, whether there's an interest in participating in a local improvement area where they would contribute. We're still soliciting information and input from the general. It was actually a small group that we met with. So we've sent out letters asking for their input. So we're gleaning that, and that'll be presented to council once we have a final picture. We're also working on traffic calming on 48th Avenue at Simons Elementary School and 50th Avenue by Condor Park. We are also undertaking sanitary sewer flow monitoring, which will inform our sanitary sewer model, and that will help us understand if there's capacity issues and where we need to do upgrades within the city, and that will help us determine our future development cost charges for new development in the future. And we are also working on 200th Street Grade Crescent, the 50th Avenue traffic study. So we're assessing whether signal coordination there will work instead of pushing Grade Crescent through to 50th. And we are designing three traffic signal replacements on Glover at 56, Glover at Duncan Way, and Glover at Eastley Crescent. Those are three of some of our older traffic signals that need replacement. And thank you. Are there any questions?
Questions. Councillor Vanderbrook, then Councillor Bahal.
Thanks, Rick. Actually, not really a question. Sendell Gardens, absolutely wonderful. Mm. Staff did a fantastic job there. It is like night and day. Absolutely amazing. So please thank them.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing, that water play, do they do anything else? Because I was thinking like recycling and don't be a litter bug and all that kind of stuff. It kind
yes.
of brought that to mind for me. So I'm just wondering, is there possibilities of other presentations?
There are possibilities, and they do other plays, environmental focused plays of nature. Yes, we could look into that.
Councillor Pahal.
Thank you. There's a question, actually, technical one, about the water meter you installed. Is that different than connecting directly into Metro Vancouver? Is this a connection between our two municipal water systems as opposed to a Metro water main?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay.
So it's really there just meant as a backup. So if there's a situation, say, where the water supply was cut off for whatever reason, that we would have an interconnect. We have a number of those in different locations within the city.
Oh, okay.
To the township, yeah.
And two more questions. For the, you said you mentioned trail paving. Is there any specific areas where you were focusing on?
We were planning to do the area around Portage Park.
Okay.
As well as the piece that's missing from 200th along the Nicomeckle between 200th and 53rd.
Okay, cool. Yeah. And then the final question is TransLink paying a portion, or are they planning to pay a portion of the 200 Street Bridge deck replacement? Because it's MRN.
It would be partially funded through MRN funds, yeah.
Thanks.
Councillor Martin.
Thank you. I just want to talk about the 203rd roundabout that is now paved and seems to be working very well. Mm. And I can only imagine it'll work even better once the telephone pole is taken out of the middle of the road and all the orange right. things are gone. But it is working very well so far, Rick. So I'm very happy to support it finally. I think it's going to be a great improvement for that area. So, and it's nice that it's all paved now. So when it's all fixed up with the greenery, it's going to be very nice.
Thank you.
Councillor Arnold.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The work that you guys have been doing in Sendell, I don't think I've had so many people come up to me and talk about how great that is. Some of the ones who live down near there and who walk through there every day, but also just people that have been down, I guess, to take a look. And they are really impressed with the work that's being done and with the way that you guys are doing it. The other question I had was about Hunter Park. And I know we were concerned before that we were going to have to lose all the trees in there. And now you're saying that some of them are going to be okay. So how many are we going to be able to keep? Well, I know we were concerned before with there being wind coming through there and so on. Is there still going to be enough trees to kind of mitigate the wind a bit?
Well, it's really only the cedars and maybe, you know, some of the other deciduous trees that are a little bit stronger that we would consider leaving. The rest, it looks like all the firs and all the hemlocks will need to go, and that's by far the majority of the trees in the park.
Okay, so is the wind still going to be a major problem in there?
I mean, it could be, and depending on where the trees are located, you know, whether it's you know, if it's closer to a house, it maybe it's a bit more of a hazard, and we still would have to remove them. We will have them assessed by once all the trees are removed, we'll have a better picture of what it looks like, and then we'll have to decide from there if further trees need to be removed.
Okay, so but it looks like it's going to be better than we thought it was.
Yes.
Yeah. Good.
Councillor Storterboom.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you for your report, Mr. Baumhoff. Very comprehensive, as always, and it certainly shows that you and your team are keeping busy.
Oh, yeah.
I'm especially keen on the project you've identified on 200th Street from 48th Avenue north to 50th, where Great Crescent comes in there, and I will look forward to how we are going to address the challenge, in my opinion, as to the flow of traffic, especially coming from 50th going east and trying to turn left on 200th Street. I'd be interested in knowing if there is any input from ICBC and if perhaps there might be some funding associated with trying to address the challenge that's there. So you're looking at all three intersections as a unit, or are you looking at that separately at 48th and 200th and then Grade and 50th?
Yeah, the project is Grade and 50th. We're looking at those two intersections because that was the question mark, I guess, around Grade Crescent, whether we pull it through to connect up to 50th or could we do it through synchronized signals.
Okay.
You know, that wouldn't cause, you know, excessive delays, say, on 200th Street.
Yeah.
So that's the main focus.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. And thank you. So 48th Avenue would not be a part of that traffic light sequencing, or is that just making things a little too complicated?
Yeah, I would need to look at it in more detail. I'm not entirely sure if we've included that, so I could look into that for you.
Very good. Thank you very much, Mr. Baumhoff. I look forward to what you can bring us. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Well, Rick.
Okay.
You're off the hook.
Thank you.
The next, we have a recreation update from Ms. Hilton, who's the Director of Recreation, Culture, and Community Service.
Well, good evening. Our presentation here for Recreation, Culture, and Community Services for November, and starting always with our special events. This Friday, we have an event happening in Douglas Park at the Cenotaph. The parade and ceremony for Remembrance Day will begin at 8:40 a.m., and we are endeavoring to provide better sound for the event so everyone will be able to hear. So we're hopeful that even with the potential downpour that's going to be happening, you'll still be able to hear what's going on for that event. We also have our Extreme Air Park event happening Saturday, November 19th for our youth. It runs from 1 to 6:30 p.m. If youth are interested, they could please phone Tim's Community Center at 604-514-2940 to register. It's that time of year again where Christmas is just around the corner and all the planning for Christmas events are taking place. And as usual, on the first Saturday of December, we do host a breakfast with Santa at Douglas Recreation Center. And all our lovely members of council are on hand to help with serving up the food and cooking, and we'll be flipping pancakes early in the morning. That runs from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. at Douglas Recreation Center. And to register, you can phone 604-514-2865. This does sell out every year, so you'll want to get onto that sooner than later. We've also had a committee busy working for the afternoon events that same day on December 3rd. And as you can see from this poster, we have crafts and entertainment starting at 4 p.m. in McBurney Plaza. And as mentioned earlier, that plaza is a very busy site. At 6 p.m., we have our annual Christmas parade. And at 7 p.m., we have our tree lighting and caroling also in the plaza. So please drop by McBurney Plaza on December the 3rd, Saturday, and have an afternoon and evening filled with entertainment. Some new programs that are starting up. The BOSU Boot Camp runs Fridays and Saturdays at Tim's Community Center, and this is a drop-in program for those who like high-intensity workouts. We also have pickleball, and we now have pickleball at our new location at Douglas Recreation Center. So pickleball runs Monday, Wednesday, Thursdays, and Fridays here at Tim's Community Center, but we also have drop-ins on Tuesdays from 1 to 3 at Douglas Recreation Center on our new floor there. So I'll show a photo of that a little bit later. Tiny Tykes Soccer, we're just wrapping up our first set of classes for recreation programs. The next set will start November 12th. It runs Saturdays, and we have two opportunities for 2 and 3 year olds and also for 4 and 5 year olds. It's a fun way to get little guys active and touching that ball and having fun. So it's all about developmental skills and a little bit of fun play. What better way to start your morning than rising up and spinning with our awesome instructors at Tim's Community Center? So you can drop by Tim's from Monday to Friday at 6:15 to 7 a.m. It'll definitely wake you up and get you a good little sweat going. It's drop-in only, and we are open 5 days a week in the morning for that rise and spin class. For more information, you can phone Tim's Community Center at 604-514-2940. Well, hip-hop is quite popular, and our next class starts November the 10th. It runs Thursdays, and we have a couple different age groups offering. And again, this is at Tim's Community Center, running in our new multipurpose room 3. So if you're interested to learn some hip-hop techniques, you can give us a call at 604-514-2940. Our Fit for Two yoga class, Mom and Baby Yoga, is running starting Mondays at noon, and this starts on November 21st. And again, you can find more information by phoning Tim's Community Center. Another preschool sports program, floor hockey. A second set of programs are starting up, and again, for a multitude of ages. great way to get the little kids out, having fun, and keeping dry. These are indoors, so this is great this time of year. And not to be left out, we do have ballroom dancing for adults, so 18 plus years. I think you get 7 different basic dances, so you can try your foxtrot, your waltz, your tango, your cha-cha, your rumba, samba, and then jive, and then you can bring it to one of our events and practice your dancing at one of our events. So for more information, you can phone 604-514-2865. This does run at Douglas Recreation Center. Just a couple projects I wanted to highlight. We're just completing our boiler upgrade at Al Anderson Memorial Pool. We've gone from one large boiler and a domestic hot water tank to these 4 inline boilers, which will allow us to warm up the pool faster in the spring when we start the season up. And depending on what our requirement is, 1, 2, 3, or 4 of those boilers will fire up to get the operations going. On a regular basis, we may only be using one, and this will help to offset some of our carbon offsets give us some savings as well. And this is the new synthetic floor. I think we might have seen a little bit when it was just being installed, but it's now up and ready and running, and we can do the pickleball, we can do volleyball and badminton in there as well. So this is a much more versatile floor for the activities that are happening at Douglas Rec Center. And that's my update for November.
Thank you. Questions? One. Okie dokie. Councillor Pahal.
Thank you. So I guess the new boilers are more energy efficient?
They certainly are.
Okay. Yep. So, yep. Cool. Do you know, I guess, not that on the spot right now, but do you know what that efficiency savings might be?
I don't, but it will be coming, I think, in a future meeting with Mr. Beto when he does his presentation.
Thank you.
Great. Oh, Councillor Albrecht, Councillor Arnold.
It's not so much a question as it is a plug for the Christmas parade, Saturday, December 3rd. I know you already put it up there, but I really want to hammer away at it. We're having prizes for the best entries in a number of categories, so make sure we get our floats and entries into the parade as soon as possible so that you can be prepared to win a prize. Thank you.
Councillor Arnold.
Okay, the mom and tot yoga. What do you call a tot?
Baby.
How old?
They're not walking. They're an infant, yeah.
Well, because I know one that's expected on the 23rd.
Yeah, they can't be too mobile because then the mother spends the whole time chasing the child, so they have to be moving yet.
So from the very beginning,
yeah, for sure.
They're not mobile yet, so.
That's correct.
Okay, thanks.
That's it. You're off the hook. Thank you, Ms. Hilton. Next, we have Rory, and he's going to give us the Langley City Fire Rescue Service update.
Thank you very much. Here's our quarterly report for November the 7th. Our calls for service has seen a slight decline pretty well across the board. So that's kind of nice to see. And hopefully that trend will continue as we head into the fourth quarter of this year. So we've gone from 803 calls for service in the second quarter down to 740. Still overall a little bit up over last year. And of course, typically our MESA calls account for 78% of our incidents, followed by public service calls at 8% and fire calls or alarms at 7%, fire calls at 5%. So of course, most of our calls for service are for medical calls and motor vehicle accidents. All right. Continuing to track our drug overdoses here within the city in October, it's very sort of up and down, and it really does depend on what particular product is out on the street. And you know, sometimes we get products that's, for example, heroin that's laced with fentanyl, and when that comes out, then we tend to see an increase in the number of overdoses. So we had 28 overdoses for October, and so that is getting up towards the sort of extreme that we had last January, where we had, I believe, 31. So for the year, we've had 197 overdoses compared to 80 last year. So if the current trend continues, we'll have about a 290% increase over what we had last year. With the introduction of our naloxone program that council approved earlier on, we've administered naloxone four times. Our fire losses have dropped right down, which is nice to see. The one sort of significant fire that we had was actually a garage fire, which was about a $40,000 loss, and that was in September. So really nice to see those stats dropping off. Training initiatives, of course, we did the naloxone training, and there's been a change in the protocol for the administration of naloxone, in that they've completely removed all restrictions for not only the sale of naloxone — it's an over-the-counter drug now at pharmacies — but there are no training requirements technically anymore, and they've also lifted the requirements of our first responders to consult with a physician on call prior to administering naloxone. So those are very good moves. It's really opened up public access to naloxone, and of course that is filtered down, and all of the restrictions or things that slowed down our almost immediate giving of naloxone when we arrive on scene. So that's been lifted off too. So good across the board. Eight paid on-call firefighters took the apparatus maneuvering course, and that is out at the Pitt Meadows Airport, conducted by the Justice Institute of BC. We've had 11 of our paid on-call firefighters take the emergency scene management course. Emergency scene management is the sort of initial entry-level command and control course that fire officers take. Now, we've had the ability through Captain Scott Kennedy to teach that in-house. He's a tremendous asset to the department because he is a JIBC Fire and Safety Division instructor. So we were able to do things like take this course and push it right down into the firefighter level. And it's really helping us, because now the firefighters, when they're around back of the building dealing with an incident, they have an appreciation for the information that the fire officer is looking for to make those decisions, and just have an appreciation for the bigger picture when handling an emergency scene. So we're really fortunate, again, to have Scott do training for us. And I think we're probably the only department around who has taught emergency scene management down to the firefighter level. We've recertified all of our first responder instructors, so they're all up to speed for a couple more years. And we started the framework for developing a rapid intervention team program. This is the firefighter rescue team that's required by WorkSafe. Whenever we enter a building, there has to be firefighters on the outside who are specifically designated and ready to go, so that if someone on the inside runs into problems, that team can go into immediate action and go in and rescue. So again, Scott Kennedy has taken the initiative, both him and firefighter Dave Skidmore, in developing this training program. And it's a very comprehensive program, and we do written tests and practical evaluations, so everyone has to pass the course in order to be certified in that. So really quite pleased and proud that we've been able to develop that program. And that training should be concluded prior to the end of this year for the whole department. And one safety message we'd like to share with the citizens of Langley: it is really, really dangerous for citizens to take their four-wheel scooters and drive down some of the paved paths in the floodplain when those paths are underwater. We had another incident here last week where an individual drove down into the water following what he believed to be a paved path. Because the waters are muddy, he drove off the path, tipped the scooter over, and that individual was sort of half submerged in the water for about 15 minutes before we got the call. So really, really dangerous if you cannot see the path, or if the path is going down into the water, please, please, please don't go in there. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Vandenbroek.
Thanks, Roy. Couple things, actually. Halloween night, it was fantastic to see the trucks out again in the neighborhoods. I live by City Park, which is very well known for fireworks and explosions and blowing things up over the Halloween weekend. It was fairly quiet this year compared to other years, but it was really, really great again to see the fire trucks out, and I know the people in my neighborhood really appreciated it, so let them know. Thank you. Second thing is, when you showed the numbers for the drug overdoses, are those actual numbers that you're treating, or is it numbers that when you go to a call, let's say, and somebody doesn't want to go to the hospital, is that included in the overdose numbers or not? So, you know, when you attend a scene and somebody's had an overdose and they don't want to attend the hospital afterwards, or they're like, no, they just want to go back and get high again.
Right.
Are those included in those overdose
numbers?
Yes, they are.
Those are calls where we've been dispatched to an overdose, and when we've arrived on scene, the medical issue that we're dealing with is an overdose.
Is specific to that time.
Okay. It doesn't necessarily mean that the person is unconscious, or it just means that they
just
have...
Just specifically an overdose call,
yes,
so to speak. Okay, thank you.
Right.
I just wanted clarification on that. Another thing is, I think it's fantastic what Scott and Dave and all of you guys are doing at the fire hall in regards to the education component. It's wonderful that you're being very proactive and you're giving everyone a really broad range of different education to understand the whole component of the job, which is very important when you're dealing with an emergency situation. So kudos to you guys for doing that. Thank you.
Thank you. I think for each one of those courses, if we had to send those firefighters to the JI, for example, to take that training, it's about $1,100. So we were recognizing a substantial cost savings by having developed the ability to teach those courses in-house. And just a comment on the Halloween night, it was very quiet for us. In fact, I think the last call that we had on Halloween was about 4:30 that evening, and we stayed quiet all the way through the whole evening, right until about 9 o'clock the next morning. So that's fantastic. It was the POC firefighters who took that initiative to drive around with the trucks. They hand out bags that have fire prevention messages and a couple of candies. And so we get out, I think we dropped off around 150 to 200 different bags throughout the community.
Councillor Albrecht.
Yeah, thank you, Rory. I was at a CP liaison or advisory committee meeting that takes in the township as well as the city a couple weeks ago. And it was right after the train derailment out in Milner. And they had brought forward an opportunity for some training for emergency response people for such events. And I just wanted to put that out there for your information. I think they were going to be forwarding the contact or the details of that training process to staff. So I just wanted to follow up to make sure that you're aware of it, and it might be worthwhile to look into, because they're looking at hazardous material or flammable material, those types of things in a derailment scenario. So, okay.
We'll certainly follow that up. We do have them from time to time. We have the CP Rail hazardous materials response chief, I believe, lives out in Chilliwack, and from time to time we've had him come to the station and deliver some training for our firefighters. The rail company is also a partner to have a rail training car, which kind of makes its way across Canada. They tack it onto the back end of a train, and they drop it off in a community and let that community go through some practical training exercises with that. And we do have the advantage of receiving that probably about every 5 years or so.
Councillor Storteboom.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Chief Thompson, for your quarterly report. congratulations again on your service award, and thank you for the 42 years of service in so many different capacities, public safety and training, for the people of British Columbia. Greatly appreciated. Councillor Vandenberg touched on Halloween. Happy to hear that it was a relatively quiet evening. I guess my comment has to do with a recent meeting I was privileged to attend on behalf of our mayor at the Fraser Health, and the fact that they appreciate our fire service accepting the responsibility of administering the naloxone. They appreciate the need for partners in addressing the epidemic of drug overdoses in our province and in our community. So I'm just expressing their appreciation. When I met with them, they didn't realize that our local fire service had actually accepted the responsibility of administering as required, and they wanted me to be sure and thank you for assisting as a partner in dealing with this terrible epidemic that we've been experiencing in our province and in our community. Thank you.
Councillor Pahal.
Thank you. Do you have any statistics this year for the number of building inspections completed, as far as just fire safety inspections?
Not with me. I could get that information for you.
Oh, that would be great. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Chief. It's great to see you again. And again, congratulations on your years of service. I've got an item under the mayor's report for the community out there. If they don't know, the Christmas Bureau is up and running. It's at the Legion Tim site on East Lee Crescent. And last year they served over 1,600 children, over 800 families. So it's quite something for this community. And on November 20th, I know my council colleague, Councillor Vandenbroek, has purchased a book of 10 tickets. She's going to the Christmas tea, the Caring for Christmas tea with nine of her friends on November 20th. And this event is very popular. It's the fifth year that it's been up and running. Last year, this event netted $32,000 for the Christmas Bureau in a single afternoon. And this was, I know Ms. Hilton was there with you know, with her kids and a friend of one of theirs, I believe. It's a very unique event because it's mainly women. There's 500 tickets available. I think there are only about 40 left. I stand corrected, could stand corrected, but as far as I know, they're down to about 40. So when you think of this community, mostly women going out, and they have the opportunity to take their mom, their aunt, or their girls to a special event. There's very few men at this. I would say there's last year there was probably about six. I think he is bringing his mother, so he'll be one of six. But it's quite an event when you think about giving back to the community. Some of the silent auction prizes, you know, they come from all around. You've got Preston Chev. You know, you've got Cactus Club, a small group or a small store, Olive Oils. You've got people that have a vested interest and love this community, like Newlands Golf Course. You've got Cascades, the Charbertin Winery in the township, the Keg in the township. You know, and then you've got a few of the specialty ladies' stores, like Forever Yours and Loris, that give every single year. Not to be outdone by my turkey farmer buddy, JD Farms. He gets involved with as well. Save On Foods, and even from the interior, we have Road 13 Winery, who's donating a Magnum of wine this year. So
and Elvis will be there.
Yes, and Steve Elliott, Elvis will be there to entertain the crowd. So it's a great Sunday afternoon, November 20th. It'll be a fun event for a lot of people. And as I said, last year they netted $32,000, all for the Christmas Bureau. So East Lee Crescent by the old Legion Tim Center, please sign up for the Christmas Bureau. So the next item we have is a bylaw. Mr. Minchuk I'll probably get you to just talk about it a little bit. It's bylaw 3004, and it's an accommodation tax bylaw. This is the first, second, and third reading of the bylaw, cited as the accommodation tax bylaw 2016, number 2004. And could you, Mr. Minchuk, just give us a brief overview?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. My pleasure. The purpose of bylaw number 3004 is to renew an additional 2% hotel tax that's applied on the accommodation sector pursuant to the provincial sales tax. This bylaw will not come into effect until August 1st, 2017. Thank you.
Moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Albrecht. Any kind of a discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. Thank you, Mr. Minchuk. We have a couple of committee reports. The first one is from the Economic Development Committee, and this is from the Business Walk Program Update. And Councillor Martin, would you like to speak to this?
Yes, thank you very much. Well, as pretty well everyone knows, in April of 2016, the Economic Development Committee partnered with Kwantlen Polytechnic University and conducted 9 industrial sector business walks. And recently, the Economic Development Committee partnered with the Downtown Langley Business Association and conducted 9 commercial sector business walk during the month of October. And I'm going to name these businesses off that we went to. It was Sports Replay, Ignite Cafe, The Wicker Tree, Viva Mexico, Olive Oils, Wholesale Sports, Travel Professionals International, Olive Phillips, and Mastermind Toys. And we purposely mixed it up this year with the commercial not being just in the downtown core, but out on the bypass, and I'm very happy that we did that. We found some common themes that were identified through the business walks, mostly stating the current state of their businesses is very positive, their location and the cost of doing business, business-friendly local government, supportive downtown business association were identified as what they like most about doing businesses in the city of Langley. Most businesses identified that they are experiencing recruitment challenges, and they also indicated they are not considering future expansion at this time, primarily due to a lot of them have recently expanded. We also identified several issues leading to the following common themes: increased business competition, criminal activity increasing, desire for freestanding reader board signage, union wages are too high for small businesses to compete, visible homelessness, improved downtown sidewalk and lane maintenance, negative impact on road construction, cost of advertising, the desire to develop mentorship programs for new business, and expand networking receptions and special events to enhance business awareness. In closing, the 2016 City of Langley Business Walk program was very positive and informative. We feel that the small business is the cornerstone of our community, driving the economy and creating jobs. We really appreciated the participating businesses' willingness to offer their respective issues and challenges and enable us as a local government and business-friendly community to take direct appropriate action. The Economic Development Committee intends to continue our Business Walk program in 2017 to further enhance our relationships and understandings. I'd like to thank Terry James from the Downtown Langley Business Association for accompanying both myself on the days that I was out and Councillor Albrecht on the days that he was out, and certainly to Mr. Beddoes and Mr. Minchuk for setting up the appointments. And Mr. Councillor Albrecht, would you like to add your take on this too, seeing how you did them?
Yes, thank you. I guess it's really important on why wait for complaints or why wait for businesses to leave. We wanted to be proactive, and I think this is a very good first step. It's important to reach out to our business community and develop these relationships and open up communication and dialogue about what their issues are, what their pinch points are, what we can do to potentially help them succeed. Because as Councillor Martin said, Our economic viability is tied to small businesses and the business that we have here in our community. So I was proud to be part of it, and I'm really looking forward to continuing this program for years to come and connecting with our valued business associations in our community. Thank you.
Can I move receipt, Mr. Mayor, on this
Seconded
report?
By Councillor Albrecht, I assume. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Now, this is just another example of this council going out to the community. We just held our neighborhood meetings, 3 of them from the south side, middle, and north side of the community. And we just like to get out there and see what the people have to say. And as Councillor Albrecht said, get ahead of the curve. So thank you to the both of you for undertaking this. So the next item we have is with Councillor Albrecht. It's the Green Team of Canada Partnership. Councillor Albrecht.
Okay, so the recommendation that council direct staff to explore a fee-for-service partnership with Green Teams of Canada to run habitat restoration events in the city of Langley each year.
And seconded by Councillor Martin. And this is out of a recommendation that comes out of your Parks, Recreation, Environment Advisory Committee?
That is correct. So we had a presentation from the Green Team. They've done work in our community before, and they focus mainly on invasive species and the removal of those invasive species and do some planting to take back some of these natural corridors into a more friendly environment. So I don't know if any staff have anything they would like to add to that.
Nothing over there. Councillor Vandenbroek?
Does this involve any goats? Because I know other communities are using goats to clear out the invasive species, and I think that's something that we should be looking at in the city of Langley as well.
According to their presentation, no goats. But we could certainly put that bugger in their ear. But yeah, no, it, no goats that were presented, no.
Councillor Martin.
Blackberry bushes might be hard on the goats. I don't know.
No, they need them.
On the bushes too?
Yes.
Prickles and everything?
Yes.
Oh, God. Send them to my backyard.
I know.
I'd just like to clarify. The motion says explore a fee for service, and it says in the report that it's $800 sort of a day or a team or whatever. So are you looking for a better price or... What are you looking for by exploring the fee for service?
Well, this is a recommendation from the committee, but our from a staff point of view, it would be something we'd want to try for a year,
right?
You know, and probably plan 3 or 4 events and see how much work we can achieve in those events and how many volunteers come out, and just make an assessment at the end of the year and if we want to continue it. It's a relatively inexpensive way, if we can clean up a lot of areas, that we can achieve a good product in the end. So
we're not going to explore that. We know the fee is $800.
Yes.
$800. So no problem, and it's going to come out of the general
right.
budget that we already have.
Right.
So, I mean, I guess we could pass this motion, but we're not exploring a fee. It's basically to move ahead with the program.
Yeah, that staff, I guess directing staff to work with Green Teams of Canada to
right.
to develop this program.
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
No, I think it's wonderful if we can get something like that, get the kids out in the community.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Councillor Albrecht?
Yeah, the committee, just in response to Councillor Martin, the committee didn't feel it was appropriate for them to be saying, you know, spend X number of dollars on the program. They just wanted staff to explore and then bring back, if necessary, to council for an approval or put into their budget process. So they just didn't want to be directing staff or telling council what they should be doing. So
just further to that, you're just going to go ahead with the program, Mr. Baumhoff? you're going to go ahead with the program. You're not going to bring it back to council.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, I don't think this motion is really appropriate, but for what they're going to do, but do it.
Councillor Storaboom.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for introducing this to us, Councillor Albrecht. I'll be supporting the motion, and I think it's really great that the committee is recommended bringing this forward. I was privileged to attend the presentation. It was delivered with tremendous enthusiasm and reasonable evidence that they're doing a great job. They're engaging people throughout the region, and they're pulling them in to connect and be involved. They're not interested in competing with LEPS, who we have a healthy relationship with, but because the job at hand is so significant, I can appreciate that there would be two groups or more who have more than enough to tackle when it comes to the challenges of our invasive species. So this is a go for me. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Okay. Mr. Councillor Albrecht, nothing further? Nope. Okay. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. The next item we have is under admin reports. And this is a clean water and wastewater fund application on Douglas Crescent from 204th to 208th. And the purpose of this report is to request council's endorsement to submit an application for the Douglas Crescent Utilities Project under the second intake of the Canada British Columbia Clean Water Wastewater Fund. And there are 4 motions. I'd like to just combine them into one, if I may. That council authorize staff to submit an application for grant funding for the Douglas Crescent Utilities Project through the Clean Water and Wastewater Fund, and that city council supports the project and commits to its share of $660,000 of the project, and that this project could not proceed without program funding, and that without the grant funding, the full scope of the project would not have otherwise been undertaken in the fiscal years 2016, 2017, or 2017, 2018. And I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Vandenbroek, Councillor Martin. Is there any kind of a discussion? Councillor Storaboom.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Mr. Baumhoff, and your department for bringing this to us. Mr. Chung, for recognizing it and encouraging us to move forward with it. I am thrilled at the tremendous grants that your department has been able to secure for our city, and I really appreciate that the city is in a financial situation to take advantage of this kind of an opportunity, especially when other levels of government are letting loose their purse strings and feeling generous with projects. It's great to know that we have the resources and the people to make us aware, to make the application, and in the end, really, get us really good value for our tax dollars. So thank you very much, and I'll be supporting this. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Further, Councillor Martin.
Thank you. I'm pretty sure I know the answer to this, but part of this motion is that this project could not proceed without program funding. So if we don't get the grant, it'll go back to 2025 was in the report, that when it's actually scheduled.
It would go to a subsequent year. I don't know exactly what year.
Whatever we could get a grant.
Or we would reduce the scope, you know, of the project, that we wouldn't have it as broad as what it is now with the application.
But if we don't get the grant, it will not be going ahead.
No, not in those years that's noted.
Right.
Right? 2017 or 2018.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. The next item I have is the deputy mayor appointments for 2017 and 2018. And these, if you look at the previous 2 years for this council, it took a lot of time and a lot of effort just to try to figure out the months so a councillor isn't doing July, August, or November, December. And they've been broken down so that they're fairly spread out for each council member. And I have to read them off. I was told earlier, December 1st, 16 to January 31st, 17, Councillor Vandenbroek, February 1st, March 31st, 2017, Councillor Bahal, April 1st to May 31st, Councillor Arnold, June 1st to July 31st, Councillor Albrecht, August 1st to September 30th, Councillor Storteboom, October 1st to November 30th, Councillor Martin, December 1st to January 31st, 18, Councillor Pahal, February 1st to March 31st, Councillor Vandenbroek, April 1st to May 31st, Councillor Martin, June 1st to July 31st, Councillor Storteboom, August 1st to September 30th, Councillor Albrecht, and October 1st to November 4th, Councillor Arnold. And that weird date at the end is because the elections are at a weird time in 2018. Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Vandenbroek. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. Councillor Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to move that the City of Langley waive the fees for McBurney Plaza for Soroptimus of the Langleys to hold their annual candlelight vigil on November the 25th, which is International Day of Elimination of Violence Against Women.
Moved by Councillor Vandenbroek. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4.
Thank you.
Well, we had a very informative night, not a lot of bylaws and not a lot of business per se, but more information on what's going on in the community to spread out to the community. So I need a mover to adjourn. Councillor Vandenbroek, Councillor Storteboom, all those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you.